I can see the excitement in your faces. I know when you look at the agenda and see Daugaard's going to talk for 20 minutes, there was just great elation. I can see it in your faces. Anytime one gets to hear from an elected official for at least 20 minutes, wow, pretty exciting stuff. That's always been true. If you go back to historical times when South Dakota still hung horse thieves, maybe you've heard me tell the story about the governor who heard there was going to be a public hanging of a fellow that had been arrested and convicted of horse thievery. And he thought, well, I better attend. There's several thousand people going to be there for the hanging. And as is customary, they led the condemned man to the scaffold and asked him, do you have any last words? And he thought a minute and he said, well, no, I don't. And the governor piped up and said, well, do you mind if I say a few words then? And the fellow said, no, but hang me first, please. I don't want to wait. Thank you all for being here this morning. I especially appreciate so many education leaders here, because workforce is in part a significant role that education plays to prepare people for the world of work, not just the world of life, but the world of work. And so thank you to so many education leaders that are here. And I know they're on the panels that you'll hear from, that we'll hear from this afternoon and this morning. I'd like to frame my remarks around three stories. The first story starts a few months ago. On September 19th, I was in Mitchell, and I had a meeting scheduled with some business leaders there and some community leaders there. And knowing that I was coming to Mitchell, some of them asked, say, could you come a little early because we want to talk to you about something? And sure, I said. So I got there a little bit early, and we went downstairs into a separate room and sat around a table, and they wanted to talk about workforce. They said they could not expand their businesses because of a difficulty in attracting workers to come to work for them. They were having to turn away business because they just couldn't get workers. And they thought, and they said, they believed that workforce was the single largest threat to their continued economic growth and development in Mitchell. I heard the same thing in Sioux Falls that same week. Coincidentally, Dusty and I, Pat Costello, and several other leaders from our office were meeting with the Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors and the Sioux Falls Development Foundation Board of Directors in a group. And the question I raised with them, not knowing what their answer would be, I said, Sioux Falls has just been a fantastic economic driver of our state. As Sioux Falls does well, the state does very well. And so I said, I'd like to hear from you if there is a single thing that the state could do to help you continue this economic growth. What is it? Tell me what that is. So we had some conversation, and then we broke into small groups, as we're going to do this afternoon. And the small groups came back together, and one of them had an idea, another one had a different idea, but all the others had the same idea. Workforce is what they said. We need help with workforce. So I'm here today in part because of those experiences. Now, I've been working on the workforce issue, like many of you, for longer than just recently. My first year in office, I visited over 40 different businesses around the state, because of course you remember we were still feeling our way out of the recession. We had bottomed in terms of job losses about the middle of 2010, but we really couldn't see that we were truly at the bottom. And when I came into office, we didn't know. The recovery was very tenuous, very uncertain. And so I was going around to businesses to see how are things going? What do you need? And I heard about problems in their workforce. And back then we responded about a year later, we responded more methodically and in an organized fashion with the South Dakota Workforce Initiative, or South Dakota WINS. You can see our logo that we put together. And in 2012, we announced 20-some programs or efforts that were collectively the South Dakota WINS initiative, trying to do what we could as a state to help you address the workforce challenges. And the panel that follows me is going to talk about some of those programs and the progress we've made, because I think it's important you understand that. But then beyond those meetings after my early years in office, or early year in office, it made me realize here more recently in Mitchell and Sioux Falls that we need to reinvigorate that issue, that effort. We need to look at it again. Now, we're not alone in South Dakota in the challenges we face. The entire nation has workforce issues. In fact, it's interesting, Mike, many of you belong to associations by virtue of your profession. I belong to a governor's association. And the National Governors Association chooses one governor to serve as chair of the association for the year. And the governor who is chair of our association this past year has been Governor Mary Fallon from Oklahoma, who I think is spectacular. And as one of the privileges of being chair, the governor gets to choose a particular issue upon which they want to focus, and an issue that they think will be held in common as an interest of all 50 governors. And what is the issue that she chose to focus on? Workforce. So it's not something that is unique to South Dakota. Now, of course, our workforce challenges are exacerbated by the result of our strong economic growth. Simply put, the growing pains of adding jobs, as we add jobs, we drive our unemployment down. We're now, of course, as we have been in the last year or so, one of the lowest unemployment rates in the nation. And so that just makes our workforce challenges even greater than in other states. You know, we have to remember how lucky we are. There's still states with unemployment rates of 8%. Ours is 3.8, I think, this month. And there are metropolitan areas whose unemployment rate is 10, 12, 14%. There's a couple of metropolitan areas, Yuma, Arizona, and El Centro, California, whose unemployment rates are above 20%. And they probably don't have very many workforce challenges, I'm gonna guess. More, they need jobs to place all those unemployed people into. We're at the other end of that spectrum. Now, during the recession, we did lose jobs. We lost about 8,000 jobs between 2009 and 10, and then we bottomed out and started to recover those jobs, and we have now recovered all of them, and then some. We've added thousands of jobs more. So that's contributed to our low unemployment rate. It's exacerbated our workforce problem, but we're not alone. So the moral of the story is, it's a problem that's going to be with us for a while, and we need to persist in our addressing of it. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon, so we need to persist. My second story starts with a conversation I had with a fellow named Terry, who's an executive at an electrical contracting company here in South Dakota. He told me their top 10 electricians make an average of $91,000. That's pretty good money in South Dakota, especially when you consider our very low cost of living and no income tax. $91,000 is a really very good salary in South Dakota. That's more than twice what 2013 college graduates are making. So that's pretty good. Now, we know that we have a national skills gap in the United States. It means that the current people looking for jobs don't have the skills to fill the job openings. There's a lot of people looking, and there's a lot of job openings, but they don't match up. In 2011, for example, when the United States unemployment rate was still at 9% unemployment, there were companies that had, in fact, there were 30% of our employers in the United States had jobs open for 6 months that they couldn't fill. Even when there's a 9% unemployment rate, we had companies with openings for 6 months they couldn't fill. Why? There were no people with those skills to fill those openings. So that skills gap exists because people don't fully appreciate the value of quality skilled jobs. And the skills gap exists because they aren't aware of the salary. And some people believe that the ticket to success in America is a college degree. That might have been true a few decades ago. Get a college degree and you'll be successful. Today, it depends on the degree. Some college degrees give you a no better job opportunity than you had when you left high school. And a lot of students graduate from college with degrees and can't find jobs because there aren't any in that field. So they've got a lot of debt. They've had a great 4-year experience, or 5-year, or 5.5-year, or 6-year experience. But they don't have a credential that gives them a ticket to a well-paying job. Today, it's more important that we examine at the beginning of our academic paths what it leads to. And will it lead to a credential that truly will provide opportunity or none? And that doesn't mean we should tell our young people what to dream or what academic pursuits they should have. People should follow their dreams, but they should follow those dreams with their eyes open. And if they want to be this or that, and there are no jobs at the end of that trail, then they should understand they're pursuing that educational path to make themselves more well-rounded or whatever other reason they may have, but it's not to provide themselves a job opportunity. Now, I know your community is aware of the skills gap, and you're taking steps to address it. I know Aberdeen School District recently had a very good application to renew their emphasis on career and tech ed, build a new career tech ed academy, and link high schoolers with career opportunity potentials in the skilled trades and some of the other areas. I think that's great. In my conversations with many of you, we've talked about the importance of our young people understanding the opportunities in skilled trade careers. One country that's a world leader in educating students in these areas is Germany. In Germany, most students finish high school between the ages of 15 and 18, depending upon the type of school they attend. And at that point, they have a choice to make. They can attend university, or they can attend a vocational training program. And this vocational program is a dual program where students attend classes and they also attend on-the-job apprenticeship opportunities. There's over 350 different career paths in the vocational track. And it typically takes between 2 to 3.5 years to complete that. And in most instances, the work experiences are direct apprenticeships, and often the employers end up offering those apprentices full-time employment at the end. The majority of German students, between 60 and 70%, follow that track. The United States, I believe, needs to continue to improve the connection between our education and our businesses so that education has an ear to what businesses need in helping fulfill the needs of the student to have meaningful opportunities after school, and the needs of the businesses to have a trained workforce available to them. Now, in South Dakota, I think we do a relatively good job of this, but I think there's always room for improvement. Now, there's one more troubling condition about that. I talked about the skills gap, the mismatch that occurred. 30% of the companies for 6 months had job openings. Let's just look at South Dakota and look at the numbers here. In a recent week, we had job openings at the Department of Labor, about 14,500 job openings in South Dakota. That's recent, very recently. At the same time, we had 16,900 people looking for jobs. So almost a one-to-one correlation. Now, why didn't they fit together? Mostly because of the skills gap that I've been talking about. But imagine we have perfect alignment. Imagine there's about 15,000 job openings, about 15,000 people looking. Those 15,000 are willing to move to where the jobs are. Those 15,000 have exactly the skills that align. That's perfection. Even if we had perfection, that leaves no room for growth at all. So if the company's doing well and gets a new order and has to hire people, now what? All the unemployed have been filled, have been placed. So that reminds us that we can't just train our own South Dakotans to fill the available jobs in South Dakota. We have to do what Julia was talking about earlier. We have to recruit. And that brings me to my third story. Peter, a fellow named Peter, was working in the manufacturing industry in Rhode Island, and he was not happy with his position, was looking. And in the manufacturing area, we have lots of job demand, just as we do in IT, accounting, financial services, engineering, healthcare. Those are the fields where we're really seeing demand. And as I say, we can't realistically meet those needs solely with people who live in South Dakota already. We need Peter to move to South Dakota, and he did. Peter took a job at Bell Brands, that's the new cheese processing plant that's opening in Brookings this year. They should be up and ramped up to full production by the end of the summer. Peter's already moved to Brookings. He and his wife have moved there. She's looking for work. He's a member of the community. They're contributing. Their kids are here in South Dakota, and their family is adding to their community. Our efforts to recruit people have been mixed. You know, and you'll see in some of the reports, the Dakota Roots campaign. How many of you heard of Dakota Roots? Quite a few of you. For those of you who haven't, it tries to bring people back to South Dakota who have some roots here. At least that's the bulk of the program. So my sister Joyce, who lives in Minneapolis, she's a special ed teacher. I can get Joyce to register on the Dakota Roots website, and schools in South Dakota, they're looking for special ed teachers, can find Joyce. And they know that Joyce is a likely good candidate in the sense of her credentials, because they can look at them right there. And they also know she wants to come back to South Dakota. So Dakota Roots, we've had pretty good luck with. In fact, we've, between Dakota Roots and another program, New South Dakotans, we've recruited about 4,300 people back to South Dakota in just the last few years. That's more than the populations of Baltic, Big Stone, Bridgewater, Bison, Burke, and Britain, all combined. So 4,300 in a state like ours, all jobs, that's a lot of people. And then they bring spouses, they bring families along with them. So now we know that recruitment is part of the answer, and we know that what we're doing now is not enough. So I'm hoping you will help us this afternoon identify effective recruitment methodologies that you have employed in your workplaces that you can help others understand how to employ those same. One of the ways I think that we can help each other and help the state is by being good ambassadors to South Dakota. South Dakota has a lot to be proud of. And I know our citizens are humble by nature, but we need to start bragging ourselves up a little bit, because South Dakota is a great state, and there's no reason we shouldn't tell that story to others. And I say we're great, but there's a lot of people that say we're great. CNBC named us America's top state for business. We should be telling people that. Barron's has named us the best run state in America. We should tell people that. We should talk about our lack of an income tax rate. We should talk about the fact that in 5 of the last 6 years, the Department of Commerce has said South Dakota has the lowest cost of living in the nation of all 50 states. In 5 of the last 6 years. So those are things that we should talk about. And then we've got a lot of other things beyond that. We've got great health care for reasonably low prices. We've got good education systems. We've got safe communities. We've got beautiful environments. It's just a spectacular place, South Dakota is, and we need to tell people that. So we need to be ambassadors. We need to be like my sister, or my wife, Linda. I've talked about my sister, Joyce, and trying to get her signed up for Dakota Roots. Linda carries Dakota Roots cards in her purse. Anytime we're out and about anywhere and someone mentions a connection to South Dakota, she's diving into that purse, pulling out a Dakota Roots card. I don't know about you, but sometimes when Linda goes into her purse to get something out, first of all, I never go in there. It's not safe. But I ask her, honey, wouldn't it be faster to go out and buy one by the time you find that in there? But she'll have the Dakota Roots card and she passes them out. We should all do that. I went to Minneapolis last year. Some of you maybe heard about that, to the Mall of America. Did anybody hear about that? And I spent time at a little kiosk at the Mall of America recruiting people to South Dakota. Now, I knew people would make fun of that, and I knew it. I meet very few people who are interested in coming to South Dakota. And I knew the media would make a joke out of it. And in fact, the Minneapolis Tribune came and interviewed me and wrote a story looking down their nose at me. And the local television station came out and filmed it and made a story looking down their nose at me. And I knew that would happen. And so I got all that free advertising, and our Dakota Roots hits more than doubled that week. So thank you for doing exactly what I knew you would do, newspaper and TV. But that's the kind of thing that we need to do. We need to recruit people, and we can't be too busy to be ambassadors. While I was at the mall, I did talk to a fellow named Brian, who has done business in South Dakota. And I wanted to talk to him about some of those business things I talked about. Oh, number one state for business, no income tax. Oh my gosh, the Minnesota income tax is killing you, Brian. I wanted to talk about that kind of thing. He didn't want to talk about that. He wanted to talk about what a beautiful state South Dakota was and how much fun it was to come to South Dakota and see the tourist attractions, go hunting. And I forget about the quality of life that is so good here. And Brian has the kind of job that he can do anywhere. And so Brian wants to move to South Dakota, and his wife is looking for a job in South Dakota. And if she finds one, he'll move here, they'll move here, and we'll have another success. So we earn those successes one at a time. And if I'm the only ambassador, or just me and Dusty and my staff are the only ambassadors, it won't work very well. But if we're all ambassadors for the state, we can have more success. So the moral of the third story is we need more skilled workers to come to South Dakota. So those three stories set the stage a little bit for you in your discussions today and this afternoon. First of all, workforce has to be continually addressed. We have to persevere. It's a marathon, not a sprint. So help me continue to work on it. Secondly, there's a skills gap. The job openings aren't matching up with the skills that we're producing with our students without the right skill sets. We've got some that have great skill sets and find tremendous opportunities, but we've got others that we're sending forth after graduation with skill sets that do nothing for them. And we need to be helpful to them so they understand that. Again, they make the choices. It's their life, not ours. But we need their eyes to be open about the choices they're making as they make them, not at the end. And then thirdly, we need more skilled workers to come to South Dakota so that our economies can continue to grow. So thank you so much. I'm going to be here all morning into the afternoon. I'm not going to participate in the small groups because I know I'm a distraction. I'm not a help in the small group sessions. But I will be here all day otherwise, learning with you and from you. And I appreciate so much the time that you're giving. It is very important to South Dakota's continued success. And I look forward to a state whose future is bright already being even brighter in the years ahead. Thank you so much.